My name is Matt Dembicki. I'm a local comics creator here in the Washington, D.C. area. And welcome to SPX. And I appreciate you guys coming out here and giving us a chance to talk about what we do locally in our various areas comic-wise. And what we'll do is go through each of our guests. I'll introduce them, and then they'll have a chance to talk about their collectives. And at the end, we'll leave about 10 minutes for any Q&As that folks have. And of course, we'll be available after, briefly, if you have any questions you want to come out and ask us personally. As I said, my name is Matt Dembicki. I'm part of a DC collective called the DC Conspiracy. And we're celebrating our 10th anniversary this year. And so I think that deserves it. Thanks. And we'll start at the end. Jason Green, he's part of a collective called the Ink and Drink Comics, and he's from St. Louis. A little bit about Jason: he's a founding member of the group and has contributed to each of the anthologies they put out. They have actually a three-man editorial team that puts together the books. The group launched as a publisher in 2010 with a horror-themed Spirits of St. Louis, which was one of the best sellers at the legendary Star Clippers independent comic bookstore behind Walking Dead. Next to him is Dan Mazur, who's an independent cartoonist and editor, publisher, author, lives in Cambridge, Massachusetts. He's part of a collective called the Boston Comics Roundtable. And he'll be telling us a little bit about various efforts that they have going on in the area, including anthologies put together, the Massachusetts Independent Comics Expo, and so we'll touch back with Dan about that. Andrew Cohen is next. He has the DC Conspiracy shirt on. He's been with the group since its creation, and he's the current editor of our free publication called Magic Bullet. That's a semi-annual comics newspaper that we distribute here in the Washington, D.C. area. Emily Gillis is next to Andrew, and she is from Baltimore, but she's part of a group here in Washington called Square City Comics, which was founded in 2010 by half a dozen writers and artists, and it's kind of expanded since then. She says that they have well over 100 members, and they put together various anthologies. Monica Gallagher is next to Emily. She hails from Baltimore, and she's part of a group that puts together a comic show there called Bmore Comics, and she'll talk a little bit about that project and other efforts she's involved in. And then Cheese Hasselberger comes from New York City, and the collective he's part of is the House of 12, who've been around for, I think, about 15 years.
We just had our 14th anniversary.
So I remember when I initially was coming to SPX before we even started DC Conspiracy, and you guys had your anthologies out, and that was foundations or got us thinking about doing our own collective here in Washington.
Yeah, there was a couple that spawned right about a year after ours.
Yeah. So what we'll do is I'll ask everyone kind of the same question. My first question, I'll just start with Cheese, and then we'll go down this way, is How did the idea come about? I mean, how did you decide, let's get together and do this collective?
Heartbreak. I was going out with a woman at the time in 2001, and we broke up. And she was a known force in the New York City comics community. And I really loved that community, and I had been a cartoonist and an animator for a long time. So in order to keep those friends, I drunkenly went on the internet to the old Comics Journal message board and said, "Hey man, we should all get together and get drunk and make comics together." And the next morning I woke up and there was like 25 people who were like, "That's a effing great idea." So a month later we had our first one, and we met at a bar called Max Fish on Ludlow Street. And there was like maybe 6 or 8 of us who showed up, and then we did a book the next year, and so we've been putting out books and running the comic jam every month for 14 years.
Monica, tell us a little bit about your group.
Yeah, 2 years ago, I was at Emerald City, and I was talking to Joey Weiser about how we wish that we could go to little casual comics conventions rather than big, giant ones where you had to pay a bunch of money and wait forever. And then people had to pay a bunch of money to get in just to see you. So we thought, well, we were just talking about like if there are casual, frequent conventions. So I started Bmore Into Comics, which is basically just a gathering of usually local comics creators in bars around Baltimore. So like every 3 to 4 months, we usually hold it at a bar and just like spread out the tables, and it's free and open to the public. And so I wanted people to be able to casually encounter comics and not have to necessarily know about it beforehand or plan and pay for parking and all that. So they can just come to a bar and hang out and talk to a bunch of comics creators. And we've done it for 2 years now, and we just started doing drink and draws too. Now we're doing them twice a month in Baltimore at the Wind Up Space. And it's for artists and writers to just come and like work on their stuff in a bar with us. And yay, comics.
All right, Emily, can you tell us a little bit about Square City?
So Square City started out as just a Craigslist ad posted by a guy named Mark Schulman. Making comic can be kind of a solitary, lonely thing. So we decided to try and see if there were any other people interested in getting together and talking shop. It started out with, like you said, about half dozen of us who got together once a month to talk about our projects. And then one of our members, Scott Kaptur, had the brilliant idea to put up a meetup page. And since then, it just blew up. We usually get anywhere from 15 to 20 people coming to every meeting. We've put out two anthologies. Our next one is going to have a Kickstarter starting next week. And it's become a great place for people to just learn about comics, share their work, share resources, and that kind of thing. That's really become the mission of the group, is to share resources and help each other make comics.
Andrew?
I guess the DC conspiracy actually originally came together at an SPX. People realizing that they were in the same kind of DC area and kind of why not meet more than just at SPX. So I think the first meeting was in like a January, and there was a snowstorm and very few people showed up. But the second one was in February, and I think like, 10 people or so came. And very quickly, we kind of settled on doing small projects. We did like 4 kind of jam books, 5 small comic shows, a few anthologies, some gallery shows. So it's been kind of like a steady group that's kind of maintained a kind of at least one ongoing project throughout the year that kind of the group can focus on. And our current thing now is the newspaper Magic Bullet.
Dan?
I moved from LA back to Boston, where I was from, in 2006, and at the same time I was getting more serious about drawing comics. I had no comics friends or community in LA, so when I got back to Boston, I thought Cambridge, I thought this is a good time to try to find some. And I was going to put on the Craigslist ad, but then I went to the Millionaire Picnic, which is a great comic book store on Harvard Square. And somebody had put up a sign that said, "I'm starting the Boston Comics Roundtable, and a time and a place to meet." So I went to the Pamplona coffee shop, and there was me and the guy who had put up the sign, who was a comics writer named Dave Kender, and we met. And the idea, it wasn't to get together and draw, but to get together and talk and share work, and we had no other particular idea beyond that, and we started going around any place we could think of where we might find other cartoonists, the comic book shops, there's a zine fair, Boston Comic Con, there was a thing called Comic Space, which was a MySpace for cartoonists, and we messaged all the Massachusetts cartoonists, and we met weekly, and it grew and grew, and there would be 8 people, 9 people, and after a few months, we showed up one day and it was just me and Dave Kender again. So we said, "What can we do to get this going?" And we said, "Well, we better print an anthology." So we sent out an email about the anthology, and the next week everybody who'd ever come to a meeting showed up because they all wanted to be in the anthology. So we started doing anthologies, and I'd say it's just taken off and grown from there. We've managed to meet weekly every Thursday night for almost 9 years now, and a lot of different projects, anthologies, art shows. We started a comic show called MICE, Massachusetts Independent Comics Expo, and our meeting's now about probably 20 people each week, and there's you know, like 300 people in our Google group. I don't know how many of them are paying attention. But I think the interesting thing is there's been a lot of ups and downs and turnover, and somehow it's managed just to keep going. And it's still every week, if you're working on something, you can bring in your pages and get some feedback or some praise if you want it.
And Jason.
Sure. Our group, Ink and Drink Comics, originally grew out of, used to be like a free monthly arts and entertainment magazine called Playback St. Louis, and I handled all the comics reviews in there as well as some other things, and there was a cartoonist doing a series in there called Pretentious Record Store Guy. His name was Carlos Ruiz, and we liked talking about comics, so we said, hey, let's just like go hang out at a bar with a couple other people we know and talk about comics, and you know, if you're working on something, bring it up there. And we did that for a couple of years, and you know, because we were all working on stuff in front of each other, we thought, hey, we should actually do a book together. Let's think about this. They had just announced a new Comic-Con. It was the first Comic-Con we had had in St. Louis in ages. It was called Project Comic-Con. It was going to be in late September. So we're like, hey, that's almost Halloween. Let's do a horror book with all the people we know that make comics. And we put it out there. We debuted it at Project Comic-Con. We sold out of our initial print run, and then we took it to... the book was called Spirits of St. Louis, so everybody would see it, say, wow, St. Louis, and there's like a picture of a zombie Miles Davis on the cover of it, really drive home the St. Louis connection and the horror connection at the same time. And so then we became like this huge success at our local comic shop, and we're like, wow, that's unexpected, I guess we should do another one. When should we do it? Like 6 months. And so we've done that regularly since 2010. We put out a new book every 6 months and a mini comic for Free Comic Book Day. They're all like 80 to 100 pages worth of comics. They're all themed around different genres. So we did horror first, then crime, science fiction, western, on and on from there. And now we're up to 87 different contributors throughout our 12 books. You know, some people have been in one. We've had, I think, 5 people that have been in all 12 of them. And just keep chugging along. We hold our deadlines and get people to contribute stories.
Cool. You know, one thing I wanted to ask everyone is, how often do you guys meet? And how important is that kind of physical meeting, you know, especially now in the age of the internet where you have some of these discussions over the internet and practically you don't have to even meet each other. How important is it for you to get together and to kind of, you know, physically sit around and maybe have a few drinks or coffee or something like that and talk about comics and, well, I guess, whatever is the mission of the group? Cheese, would you like to start?
Yeah. For me and for our group, I think it's integral that we get together in person. I think it's the whole point of it was to form a community. The books and the art shows and the rest of it sort of comes secondary to yanking everybody out of their studios and getting them to work together on collaborative projects and what have you. It was all about, you know, meeting other cartoonists in the area and making connections and hanging out and having a good time. So I think it's really important that you meet. I don't think it could be done online.
Monica?
Yeah, that's kind of the whole point of it, is to get you out of your house and talking about comics with other people. And then it's important, too, I think, for other people at the bar to see you talking about comics and doing comics so that they know it's still out there. It's still a thing that people do.
It's to remind you that you're not alone.
Right.
Yeah, there's
right.
Like, you know, there's 10 or a dozen or 20 other people, you know, while you're sitting there scratching on your piece of paper, there's 20 other people doing the same thing somewhere out there in the city. And
yeah, and having the same problems, right. You know, that they need to conquer and work through the same stuff, so.
Yeah, exactly what they're saying. You know, the whole point was to get together and know that there are other people doing the same thing, going through the same things. We have a forum where we can post resources and stuff, but I find that's not nearly as inspiring and motivating than getting together and talking with other people face-to-face about their projects and their problems.
How often do you guys get together?
About once a month.
Okay.
I would just kind of underscore all that. And like what some other people are saying, we have a Facebook group currently, and you know, there's probably several hundred people who are kind of have liked it or are part of it. But you know, the vast majority probably don't come out, or you don't know if they're paying attention. So we meet once a month, and I think that's kind of really crucial. That's kind of the, you know, 99% of the group is kind of getting people to come out, because that's when people are more likely to kind of finish a project that they're working on, and kind of see what other people are doing. You just kind of get to know one another, and I really think that's kind of, you know, the main point.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's to me, it's absolutely the essence of it, and the kind of keeping up that week in, week out, keeping up with each other, always there for new people to come in and get some support. And for me personally, since it started really the month that I moved to, well, a city I hadn't lived in for 20 years, so I had no friends there, pretty much all my friends are from this group. So, and I don't socialize very much, but I know every week I'm going to go to a little party, a little comics party.
Yeah, our group meets monthly. I do think it's really important. A big thing for us, I guess, because we do the genre-themed anthologies, part of the whole point of that is getting people to do stuff that they've never done before. You know, for example, we did Western. A lot of people aren't that into Westerns. It's like, you know, as soon as you start thinking, what can I do with cowboys? You know, you come up with something. One of the cool things about bringing everybody together at the meetings is a lot of times that spitballing happens in real time. If you don't mind me telling a brief anecdote. When we had our fantasy book coming up, one of our writers hadn't found an artist yet. And the one artist that still was trying to come up with something, he's like, okay, this is a fantasy anthology. Everybody else is doing knights and wizards and dragons. But you know what I want to do? I want to do a story about airbrushed fantasy art on the side of like 70s minivans. Can you come up with something? And the writer's like, well, I can try. And so they sat there and they talked back and forth. And so he came up with this brilliant Twilight Zone-esque idea where there's this wizard trapped on this van and he talks to this nerdy kid and tells him, you know, if you agree to let me cast a spell on you, you'll be all powerful and women will fall at your feet, and the kid agrees. And then pop, they switch places, and now the kid is trapped on the side of the van as a barbarian with a woman around his leg and all that stuff that he's a painting now. And the wizard's just like, oh, you idiot, and walks away. This brilliant little story, you know, 4 pages, it's got a great punchline, you know, it's completely different than everything else in the book, and it never would have happened if those two people weren't in the room together. So that kind of creative energy fires our meetings and really makes them worthwhile to come to. And they've expanded a lot. When we started with 4 people, now it's rare to have less than 40 people there. And one of our guys is a local college professor. He'll bring his whole class in sometimes, and then we're just drowning in people, you know, all working on different things at the same time. It's pretty amazing.
We'll start with Jason on this question, work down this way. What's kind of like the biggest challenge in kind of organizing a group like this? I mean, you guys are pretty much kind of leaders in your various groups, and what's kind of the biggest challenge, whether it's, you know, keeping folks inspired or finding a meeting location sometimes, or so maybe talk a little bit briefly about that.
Yeah, we did have to hunt around for a meeting location. We used to meet at Applebee's because they had cheap food and half-price appetizers. And then we were like, hey, we're this really cool hyper-local thing. What are we doing meeting at a chain restaurant? We ended up lucking into a place that it's actually a restaurant with a concert venue attached that doesn't have concerts on Tuesdays. So we meet in the concert venue. They give us run of the place. Sorry, what was the first part?
About the challenge.
Oh, the challenge, yeah. Our big thing is deadlines. I mean, we basically admit every book has a hard deadline and then a soft deadline for the people who are almost finished but not quite. And just it always seems like we're not going to have enough to fill a book when we're 2 weeks out from the deadline, and then just get the flood. So there's a lot of, you know, a lot of sweating going on, but keeping people on task and making sure that we get enough input for each book because we are on that schedule can be a challenge.
Dan?
I guess on one level, the biggest challenge is sort of that the tension between keeping it sort of as it started, very informal, with no real structure, and everyone just sort of agreeing on doing stuff, and then reaching a point where there are enough personality conflicts and differences of opinion that you have to formalize decision-making procedures. And you know, at a certain point, we kind of, you know, we. All the decisions used to just be made at our general meeting, and then we realized we were just having these awful arguments.
Now you need a quorum and stuff.
Yeah, you know, and so we had to like create a little leadership group that could argue without boring everybody else. And then I guess diversity, you know, and dealing with, you know, some issues that have come up around sexism and things like that, which is probably the real thing that led to having more rules and ways that we made decisions and ways that we made sure that issues that were kind of being ignored were addressed.
Andrew?
I would say probably two of the biggest challenges were finding a good meeting spot. We typically meet on Sundays, and we used to originally met at a bar in Virginia. It was like an old car dealership that was perfect. It was like huge, had great beer, it was quiet. And then when that closed down, finding a place that's like easy to get to for people, that like is kind of fun to be in, that's not like a sports bar where it's gonna be really loud. That's actually can be fairly challenging if you're expecting more than 6 or 10 people. And then I guess this, another issue that's kind of, is we are a very informal group. We don't have like leaders or protocols or anything like that. But just kind of finding a system where people don't just kind of follow. If you propose an idea, someone will volunteer to lead that idea and kind of edit it and see it through. And where that's not just the same like kind of three people doing it, where people are kind of inspired and kind of feel comfortable saying like, I will take care of this, I will do this. That can be a challenge, I think.
Emily?
I'd say our biggest challenge is decision making. We try to keep it a very democratic group, so everybody has a say in what we do, where we meet, that kind of thing. But when you send an email out to the group, hey, what day works best for you? And then you get radio silence. It's very hard to find places to meet and times to meet like that. When you get to the meeting, everybody is very involved, and it's easy to come to decisions like that. But outside of that, it can be very difficult.
For our group, we just started doing the drink and draws twice a month, and it's just the first and third Wednesday, so it's just show up if they want to. So luckily I don't have to worry about that, but our events when we do them is once, maybe like every 3 or 4 months, and it's not hard at all to find people who want to participate because it doesn't cost them really much and they get to hang out in a bar and sell comics all day, but like promotion is just the worst. I hate, get a bunch of people who hate promoting themselves and then try to all promote yourselves together. It's the worst.
I can understand that because whenever we as a group, you put something out that intuitively would seem like they would share that on Facebook, and you don't get the likes or the shares, you're just like, come on, folks. Cheese?
Yeah, no one wants to.
For us, it's attendance. It's recruiting. We've had our spot in the bar that we're currently doing at for 7 years, mm-hmm. and they love us there, so they're never going to get rid of us. But it's getting people to show up consistently. Some weeks we'll have a dozen people, sometimes we'll have, I think the lowest we've ever had is 4. But the biggest we've ever had is 25 or 30. But yeah, getting people to come consistently it tends to be a little harder than it should be. At least I always thought it would be.
Now, obviously you have, all your groups have certain projects that are kind of like the keystone projects for you, or a big project you're particularly proud of. Maybe we just talk briefly about that. Jason, would you like to start?
Sure. I guess one of the coolest things we did, we realized that 2014 was going to be the 250th birthday of St. Louis. So we decided, let's throw the genres aside and do a book about our city. And we got a lot of really cool contributions, including one from Dan Zetwak, who's an Ignatz nominated cartoonist from St. Louis. And another one that was a fantasy story about the Cardinals, written by one of the Cardinals beat writers for the St. Louis Post-Dispatch. So he took all this knowledge he had about the baseball team, made this story. There's also a lot of really other cool stuff in there, and it's been really successful for us. The other big thing is our new book, Sober, which we're debuting here at the convention, is a nonfiction anthology. So it's got autobiographical, it's got historical fiction, or historical stories, that kind of thing. But with this book, we're crossing over 1,000 pages of comics that have been created within the group. And for the most part, it's stuff that probably never would have happened if the group didn't exist, because the stories are driven by the book topics. So it's kind of makes me feel proud to say, 1,000 pages in 5 years is pretty cool.
Congratulations.
Dan?
Well, I would definitely say the anthologies are really important to keeping people working, motivated, having projects together. And in fact, we went through a period where we weren't doing anthologies. And I think we really saw that was needed. So the anthologies are really important. But I would also talk about recently, like this year, in the past year, we've had kind of an influx of new and enthusiastic members, one of whom is an artist, filmmaker, cartoonist, and she had a studio space, and her studio mate left, so we're actually renting half of her studio, and we've turned it into kind of a creative community space where we can have events where creators give talks and presentations. We're starting to teach classes to the public there, and also a space where people can sort of pay an extra fee for a shared studio space. So that's very exciting because it's just opening up possibilities that we could never have done before, and bringing in audiences to things that we didn't really have a way to bring them in. You know, people who are interested who maybe aren't comics creators but want to hear about it and see more work.
Our current project right now, which I have a copy of, is Magic Bullet, which is a free comic newspaper that we do. We do it twice a year, typically have one in the winter and one in the summer. And it's the way it works is just every artist gets one full page to kind of do whatever they want. And it's typically about 30 or 40 pages of comics. And it's been really good as a way of kind of getting new people, kind of meeting new people and kind of getting them involved. But it's also to kind of getting advertising and working with like some of the local comic stores and some of the local conventions. It's been a great way to kind of get to network and kind of get closer with some of like the kind of economic infrastructure of comics, and some of the kind of the business side that artists don't always also get a chance to deal with. And it's also been really good, I think, because when we print, you know, 5,000 copies and they come in big bundles, the expectation is that people will come and pick up a bundle and help distribute it. So people kind of meet each other then and they kind of get involved in a little bit and they feel like they have a little bit more of a say in it, I think.
Yeah, we've got our anthology series, and like I said earlier, we're working on putting out our third one right now. These projects are basically to help our members get the experience, get their work out there, and kind of learn how to put together a book. Our first one was really more of a promo book of projects we already had going on. Our second one was kind of a free-for-all. And our latest one, we've worked hard in really crafting kind of a world for everything to be set on, and it's provided opportunities for members to team up and try working with writers if they haven't done so in the past, etc. But yeah, anthology projects.
My group doesn't have an anthology project, which I'm really glad about. I'm really relieved. It's a lot less
you
work.
Put together these quarterly.
The quarterly events are nice. And our last one we had, we decided to have these little mini panels because we hang out in a bar that has a Twin Peaks themed stage. So we get to, like, two of us will go up on the stage and then just like interview each other. And it's been really great because we did have a guy who works in a comic shop. So he got up there and just told everybody like how to get your stuff in comic shops. So we're trying to use it not just for people who want to get into comics and do it themselves, but for other people to know like what's out there and what local comic shops are interested in indie and being all part of the same community. So we're proud of that.
For me personally, our keystones have been like, we put out anthologies, we do the jams for every month, but personally, the keystones have been seeing the people who I've, you know, sort of found or fostered go on to do, you know, get Eisner nominations, win Ignatz's, you know, go off and get picked up by bigger publishers and do really great work. You know, people who come in, they're doing little chicken scratch drawings, you know, drawing dick and fart jokes in our comics, and then, you know, a few years later, they're, you know, winning awards and getting picked up by Fantagraphics or somebody and doing like really, really excellent, excellent work. That's what makes me the most proud, is watching the group, the individuals of the group really really take off.
Kind of actually, it's a great segue for my next question was, in particular your groups, you know, this is a good place to kind of like foster people who are new to the comics field, or you know, just new to creating comics. And I think everyone here in the group has had some, you know, really kind of success getting beyond just, you know, your little kind of communities and kind of branching out, whether it's launching in some, you know, you have members now that are published by bigger publishing companies, or you've reached out to the community and help expand comics in general, the understanding of comics, and maybe you're a feature now in art exhibits or doing presentations at local book meetups and stuff. So, you know, Cheese, if you want to add to that, and then we'll go back, we'll go with Monica next about that, and maybe kind of describe briefly about those successes you kind of touched upon.
Right, yeah. Yeah, we've had people who've come to our jams, and then they, like, they'll be in our anthologies, and then they'll move to another town, and they'll start their own jams and their own anthologies. And that's always, that's happened twice now, and I've really enjoyed that, where it's like, you know, we've inspired not just the people in our town, but they've gone on to inspire people in other cities. So that's always cool. That's neat.
Yeah, one thing I would love is if every city had like constant, continuous little mini comic things in bars, because I would go to them all the time. I think that's just a great way to keep it in everyone's mind. And like, it's, I mean, part of being in this community, which takes a while sometimes, especially when you're new, to realize is that you're all in it together. You're not competing. I think there's a lot of problem when you're starting out. You feel like, well, everybody out there is so good, I can't possibly compete with them. And no, you shouldn't, because you're all trying to get more and more people reading comics. You're trying to get more comics out there. So yeah, that's, I think, the main part of like our message is just getting more people seeing it and more people doing it and more people involved.
I will say, you've inspired, like, I've read about your events before I came, and you've inspired me. I've had this idea for a long time. There's a microbrewery in St. Louis that has, they're set up like a German beer hall with these giant wooden tables that I look at it, I'm like, this would be a wonderful Comic-Con. So now I'm going to harass them when I get back, see if they'll let us do it or
it's
not.
Easy. Well, I saw someone, I forget who it was, some comics creator had a table in a grocery shop, and I was like, that's brilliant. Like, by the front door, they had all their comics. Like, they should just be everywhere.
Like food trucks.
Yeah. Exactly.
Selling comics out the back.
Exactly.
And same thing, actually, the Bmore Into Comics events inspired my group to start their own little thing. We had our first open house earlier this year, and I'm hoping we do more of them, because it's just such a great idea. But my favorite thing about Square City is just inspiring people to get into comics. We've had people show up to me, so like, oh, I could never draw a comic, I'm a print artist or whatever. And I remember one conversation I had with a girl who basically said exactly that, you know, I don't think I could ever write a story. We had a long conversation where I basically convinced her, yes, you have a story to tell, write your story. And the conversation ended with a big old hug. It was just the best feeling I ever had. So that's what I'm proudest of in my group, is inspiring people to take the next step and make your book.
I think one of the neatest things, especially at least like through the Magic Bullet, it's been that it's like a nice one thing that kind of shows kind of how much comics making is going on in the area, at least in this particular area. So a lot of people will say, you kind of will give them an issue and you say, well, it's all local artists and writers. And they'll say, you know, that they had no idea that this was out there. And they're kind of, you know, always ask again, are these really all local? But one of the other neat things about it is the way it kind of circles back through the community in kind of odd ways. So one experience we had recently is the DC public libraries are doing a lot with things like 3D printing and bookmaking. And so a copy of the newspaper kind of circled back to them. They thought that was kind of the thing that they would like to also be involved with, something similar. So then they kind of reached out to us. So now we're kind of doing something with the library. So kind of seeing the way things kind of circle back through the community and get kind of passed around, and hopefully kind of expanding a little bit kind of outside of like some of the normal kind of comic book kind of scene or stores that you're used to has been a lot of fun.
Yeah,
I mean, definitely young in comics years artists coming in, and, you know, it's really hard work, and, you know, I think that just encouraging and giving, you know, constructive criticism and taking everybody's work seriously, giving them, you know, giving them a place to be published for the first time, that's very, very gratifying. And then we started MICE and really kind of working on reaching our particular community and expanding and you know, getting them interested in independent comics. And one time, there's a member of our group who does mental health, sort of autobiographical mental health oriented comics, and they sold their comics at Mice, and there was a post on their live journal, I think. Basically, someone said, "I read your comic. I was feeling really bad and, you know, terrible, but I recognize so much." And basically saying that they were kind of pulled back from the brink of suicide. So that I feel like, okay, we've saved one life. That justifies our entire existence.
Well, I don't think I can top that, but but I'm going to try anyway. No, I guess one of the coolest things from, you know, because we do have a very educational atmosphere at our Ink and Drinks, and so we've had guys who approached us who are writers from other mediums. They've always liked comics, but they never tried to make comics because they didn't know any artists. We've had some screenwriters and some novelists. They come out, and they get inspired by the artists that are there. And we've had at least two writers that went on to meet an artist at an Ink and Drink, do a Kickstarter for a graphic novel successfully, and get the graphic novel out there. And again, it's something that, you know, it may have seen the light in a different form, maybe, as a movie or a novel, but the comic was something that happened because of the Ink and Drinks. So,
well, it's maybe we talk a little bit about, besides the regular meetings you guys have, about doing bigger events or creating bigger events yourselves. I think most of you have had an opportunity either to put on a show or create a show, and maybe you could talk about how was that? I mean, how was it approaching the venue, and then how was the success of the shows you put on? You want to start, Jason?
Yeah, we haven't from scratch done any events, but through our connections, especially through Star Clipper, the big indie-friendly shop in St. Louis, we've participated in a lot. One that was really cool this summer is they did a Comics University class series where it was like 13 classes on all kinds of different things, like how copyright works. They had one that was like a zine making workshop. You show up that day with nothing in your hands and you make a zine there. I did a presentation on music and comics and how different artists tackle showing music in a medium without sound. A lot of really cool, somebody did one on memoirs, a lot of really cool topics, and they rated our Ink and Drink group for at least three or four of the presenters for it. So we didn't have to plan it, but it was really cool to participate in it.
Dan, you talk a little bit about Mice?
Yeah, so as I mentioned, we had kind of found a lot of members at the Boston Zine Fair in 2007, and the Zine Fair had been going for a bunch of years, and the person who'd run it and kept it going was burning out, and we said, well, let's kind of take over the Zine Fair, and then realized that there, well, first, I happened to be teaching a comics class at the Art Institute of Boston, and I thought, they'll never say yes, but I said, would you like to hold a Zine Fair in your art building? And they said, yeah. So basically, that evolved into Mice. We realized that there were no non-comics making zine stirs taking part, so we changed it into an independent comics show. That art school got bought by Lesley University, which had a great big building. And you know, while there have been issues and it's been a lot of work, we're basically really lucky to have this this institution giving us a pretty good space. It makes a show that's free to the public and cheap tables possible. And then what happened with Mice, and I think it's happened in a couple other areas, is things kind of almost outgrow the group itself. So we started to want to bring in more artists from outside and special guests, and it no longer, you know, it's actually no longer even officially connected really with Boston Comics Roundtable. It's its own thing. And we're having, you know, we have to turn away some of the local artists, which is hard. In the meantime, our meetings moved to the Cambridge Public Library, and the woman who runs programming there loves the group, and she's saying, well, can't you do a show here? Can't you do a show here? So we're hoping to start, like, to start again from scratch with a small local comics group that, you know, can then outgrow us, and we'll have to start another one. But But so yeah, but I would say that, you know, if you're in a community, the real key to being able to start a comics show is the venue, is finding whatever space that's not going to cost too much and they want to have you there, because that's the, you know, without that, nothing.
Andrew?
Well, as far as like finding venues and things for comic shows, I think you're really the one with the kind of the most experience in our group for doing that part, so I'm going to punt to you on that. but I will say for kind of things like gallery shows or doing a kind of an art exhibit of some sort, I mean, like, different places, you know, depending on kind of how sort of gallery scene they are or kind of how offbeat they might be, we'll have different rules about, like, queuing up artists to schedule them for shows. But when you can go and say, like, you know, we're part of a local comic book group, these are kind of working pages from various projects, it's all local people, and it's kind of representative of a small scene that most people don't know about. Most galleries are really excited about that, I think. So it might be hard to kind of schedule something because of scheduling reasons, but they're oftentimes like very enthusiastic about wanting to do something or figure something out. So I think kind of having that local nexus is kind of a key selling point there.
We just had our first event this year. We had the Square City Open House. As far as finding a venue, the first thing that came to mind for me was Phantom Comics, which is a great comic store. If you all haven't been, you should totally go. I'm not being paid to say this. But I went to the manager and said, hey, we want to do this kind of mini show. And she was all, yes, hell yes, let's do this. So easy peasy there for me. What I should have done, though, to make it more successful was check what was going on that weekend. What we learned belatedly was that it was the same weekend as the Pride Parade. So, you know, we had that going on outside. It was a little hard to get people to come inside and celebrate comics with us. But I definitely learned a lot to put into the next show. It was a total blast. Absolutely worth it.
How hard is it to find the venues?
Oh, me?
Yeah.
It's easy. You just go to a bar and see how big it is. And then
are they
see how
receptive
many...
to it, or is it something
that's
a hard sell?
It's surprisingly easy. The first bar we picked was Bad Decisions in Fells Point, which is an amazing bar in Baltimore, and it's tiny. So he was like, yeah, see how many people you can fit. So we just put the tables against the wall, and there were only six of us, I think. And then you ask them, you know, how much they want to charge you, and a lot of bars won't charge you. They're just because they usually open at 5. So if you say, like, we're going to do it from 12 to 5 on a Saturday, it's just extra money for them if anyone comes in, if you can get anyone to actually come in. So that was the best, to just like put out a sandwich board and then people would stumble in. And so it's actually pretty easy. Just go to a bar and see how big the space is. And then what we started for creators, my only rule is you have to have comics to show or sell. Like, you can't just have illustrations or just have merchandise. Comics have to be a part of it. And then you have to have whatever money that we need to rent the space or to pay for postcards and stuff. So.
Jeez.
We've never done a show. Not a bad idea, though. Yeah. So maybe next year.
I can tell you from our experience with DC Conspiracy very briefly. We started 10 years ago. We met at this bar called Dr. Dreamos, which again was this old car dealership that they turned into a brewery. It was so big that we decided we were going to put a show there. That's how huge this place was. And we not only made it a comic show, we really made it, we call it the DC Conspiracy Counterculture Festival. We had comics in the afternoon. In the early evening, we had like shows like belly dancers and magicians and stuff. And at night, we had rock bands playing. So it was really kind of like a mini festival. And same thing with what Monica was saying. This bar typically opened up at 5 o'clock. But we wanted them to open, I think, at 3 or 4, which I think they were a little reluctant to. I don't think they got up till 3 or 4. But, you know, when they actually, the first time they opened it, the people that showed up was amazing. By the third time, we had three shows at that venue. They had a line outside the door going around the block to have people come in. It was truly amazing. And unfortunately, once we lost that was such a perfect venue because it was so big, that when they closed, they lost their lease and they closed, that's when, you know, we tried to continue the show. I had at another venue, like a smaller bar, and it just wasn't the same. It didn't have the same vibe. And we were also looking for a place where we can meet monthly, you know, and have our drinks and chats. And that kind of affected us, I think, for a couple months until we found, you know, a good fit for us. So thanks for letting me just take that segue very briefly. You know, final question, and I'm going to ask this question after we'll have a brief Q&A if there's any questions folks want to ask. But have you guys thought about, like, what's the next step for your group? You know, sometimes formal groups or informal groups have kind of, like, things they want to attain, things they want to achieve. What is it for you? Cheese, would you like to start?
Now I want to do more personal projects. I want to do more, like, individuals projects. We've done anthologies, but now I want to do, like, I want to print that guy's book and that guy's book and that guy's book.
Yeah, like you want to be more of a publisher then? The House of 12 more of a publishing type of thing?
Yeah, maybe have a publishing arm of it.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's not, it's, you know, we can have, you know, everybody can have an individual book at the table instead of just, you know, all these anthologies. And then maybe I want to do some of us were talking last night about doing more digital stuff. Mm-hmm. We did 4 issues of anthologies on Comixology, and maybe we'll go back and do another few more of those. And maybe a little show somewhere. That's not a bad idea. I never thought of that.
Yeah.
I like the bar idea. That's a really good idea. Yeah, I've already got a bar and plenty of space. So
just put prices on things.
That's awesome. That's great. Such a good idea.
Monica?
Yeah, for us, we'd like to have more than 3 or 4 times a year, as long as it's not too much extra work for us to plan. But one thing I really want to do is get libraries more involved and get the comic shops more involved, because we've had our local comic shops like Collector's Corner and Amazing Spiral and Atomic Books have all wanted to be part of it, but kind of the point is that we're having them in places where people don't go normally to find comics. Like, we want to have people, like, encounter them. We don't want, like, people are already going to a comic shop, so it's kind of, I don't know, that's kind of been my problem, like, how to involve them without... Exactly. So it's like, yeah, maybe we could just have those comic shops be with us in the bar somewhere else. But we did start doing, and I want to, maybe we can hold them in libraries or something, but we did start having our own little comics library, so people, when they come, they contribute to it, and it's just a free pile of comics. So now when people come in off the street, they can just take comics that aren't ours. Ours are for sale, but they can just, like, there's a grab bag of comics that they can just read and pass around. So I don't know. That's our next challenge, is involving libraries and involving comic shops, I guess.
Cool. Emily?
I'd really like to make more opportunities for our members to get their work out there, more open houses, maybe holding workshops and things like that for people to talk about their process and things like that.
Andrew?
I mean, it's kind of hard to say what we kind of ultimately want to do. I think, like, right now we're in kind of a pretty good spot, like, with the newspaper and the people who are involved. One of the kind of, like, I think the guiding sort of ethos of the group a little bit has been, like, what's good for the group is good for the members, and what's good for the members is good for the group, that they kind of cross-promote that way. So kind of seeing new people come in and then kind of start to make their own comics and get seriously involved, and then seeing people, you know, who might kind of start in the group doing small things, but then, you know, gradually put together something to pitch to a publisher and sort of moving on. I think kind of that kind of influx and exflux of people, I think, is kind of maybe what we're looking at right now.
Yeah,
I mean, I think I mentioned a couple of the things that we're either just starting or hoping to start, like the new small library comics show and the workspace classes are starting and these creator talks. And in fact, I think we're at a point where we have so many ideas that certain people are starting to burn out trying to execute them. And I think that, you know, while it's good to cultivate, like you were saying, the not just followers, but the initiative, the reality is there's always going to be a limited number of people who are going to be doing the heavy lifting. So I think thinking of that as a budget, almost, like how much energy do we have, and, you know, we can't feel too bad if we don't do everything that we think would be a great idea. But listening to Monica, I'm really thinking also about, you know, like, well, I bet you could get, like, just a street vendor permit and put out a blanket in Harvard Square and
exactly.
Cover it with minis and
call it a convention.
Yep.
Comics card.
Exactly.
Yeah, a shopping cart sort of thing. So maybe that's the next step.
Jason?
Yeah, one of the ideas we've been batting around, now that as the attendance has bloomed at the meetings, artists generally have an easy time showing their work, getting comments on it. But it's pretty informal. And then writers, you know, it used to be we'd hand around scripts to read at meetings, and now that just doesn't happen anymore. So one of the things we've been batting around is doubling the number of meetings we have from once a month to twice. And so one of them will still be the social hour that it always is. And then the other one will alternate between having like writer's tables. So if you want to come, you've got a small group of like 4 or 6 people. You review your story in whatever state it's in, get comments from people. And the next month we do one for artists, because we've had artists request things like, hey, I want somebody to show me how to letter in Manga Studio, or how to do gradients on colors, because I always use flats or that kind of thing. To add in that educational part of it that was easier to do when there was fewer people. The challenge is that the three of us that run it all have full-time jobs, all have wives, all have kids under 5. So having the time budget to get out of the house twice a month is kind of hard. But
we actually also do have once a month before our regular meeting, we have the writers' meeting, and they as one person organizes it, and they have a Google group or something so that they post scripts week in advance and everyone's supposed to read it, and they're pretty good, like a good writer's workshop.
Cool. Yeah, that's a good idea.
Yeah.
All right, well, thanks. We'll take some Q&A. If anyone's got any questions they'd like to ask, now is the time.
Why do you need those colorful grapes?
It matches the SPX color, so we decided to keep everything just steady.
Does anyone else want to address that?
Anyone else?
They match my eyes.
Yeah.
I can't tell.
Hey, excuse me. Anybody who has any questions, there's some mics over on the sides. If you don't mind going to those so we can record them for posterity.
Sure. So that's a little close. Hey, so you're all leaders in your communities. You've talked a lot about the roles of leaders and the way to kind of manage the energy budget. But what do you want out of your followers? Like, what would be a good core foot soldier of the Boston Comics Roundtable or Be More Into Comics?
I just want them to draw comics, and that's kind of the core thing. Come to the meetings, bring some work, get good advice and feedback, and print it yourself, or we'll do the anthology. But I just think that's the main thing, is just that people draw comics and get everything that you get out of drawing comics or writing comics.
I would love for somebody to handle like getting the word out. Just do that.
Marketing, right?
So you're marketing is the worst. Perhaps.
Yeah, it's the same for us. I mean, I have my names on all the books, so I want them to be as good as they possibly can. And one of the cool things about working in a group is you've got that one-upsmanship where everybody gets better from book to book because the new book comes out, and they're like, "Oh, I want to be the best story in the next book." So I mean, been fortunate that happens, but yeah. I want good comics that make them easy for me to come here and sell them to people.
Yeah, I think also when people do get involved, that they feel as though like they're part of the project and not just that you're like doing them a service by publishing them. So like if you say let us know if you're interested, they'll say yes, I'm interested. Like they'll follow the specs. They'll tell their friends on Facebook or whatever. That like they kind of feel like they have some kind of small part in helping to make it a successful and kind of easy experience.
Any other questions? Yes, sir.
So there's always an element of serendipity, I'm guessing, when you're trying to put together a show or a meeting or an anthology, and that the community kind of just rises up and you find people. But is there ever a time when kind of feel the need to recruit new artists or creators or writers? And if so, how do you go about it?
I feel that constantly, and I have no idea. we started a Tumblr, we have a bunch of followers on there. So we publicize the jams there, we publicize them on Facebook, we do them, social media, Twitter, whatever you got. But it's getting people to keep forwarding those posts and invites. That's hard, but recruiting is tough.
And for our group, I would say Magic Bullet, a free newspaper, has been our best marketing material. Because yeah. we leave that, we try to not only just leave it at comic shops, we try to leave it at bars, bookstores, coffee shops, gaming places, surf shops. And, you know, as Andrew can tell you, you know, initially when we brought it, I bring it to a surf shop, you know, they're like, dude, what is this? But now when they see me, they know exactly what it is, and they get all hopped up on it, and they're ready to go. And so I think spreading the word that way by just giving a publication where it's visual has helped us get a word out about our group really and also bring folks to us. Mm-hmm. We've had really a lot of new folks come in, not only do comics, but actually participate in the process, whether they're good at layout, like our production guy is a fairly new guy in it, and or marketing. So at least for the DC Conspiracy, that itself has really helped us.
Yeah, and I would just add that, you know, one of the things we're in our group is we are a very kind of white male group. And so Magic Bullet's been kind of a good way to kind of look for lots of people, you know, who don't fit that demographic, and kind of encouraging them to, you know, here's this great opportunity, you get a full page, you should do something. And then they're kind of, once there's at that point, they're sort of like in our system, you know, we have their kind of, we send them the email address, you know, the email blast about when it's being distributed. They'll come to a meeting to pick up a bundle and kind of meet people then. So it's a great way of trying to kind of get people who, you know, for whatever reason, you know, might not find the group or might not feel comfortable when they just kind of see it online. And kind of trying to affirmatively reach out and kind of a way of kind of offering them an opportunity and hopefully kind of, you know, sort of getting them interested and coming up more often.
How often do you put this out?
We do it twice a year. Like you were saying, with kind of the energy budget, we probably have enough like submissions. We could probably do it more. But just as far as like making sure that it stays fun and doesn't become a drain and a drag.
Do you keep replenishing your places where you bring it to over that 6 months? Like, so you keep distributing it?
We do. Yeah. We try to budget how much we leave there, so we don't leave too much, so mm-hmm. it doesn't just turn yellow. Yeah. But we do that. All right, folks, I have to wrap it up. Unfortunately, I want to be aware that there's another panel after this. If you guys can just help me thank our panelists today.